Hello everyone, let us start our first session or the first lecture on the series of lectures on the lower genitourinary tract series. So this is the first lecture in which we will consider the broad topic of the urinary bladder injuries, and in last 5 minutes we will have overview of the acute urinary retention. The objective of this session are to introduce the surgical anatomy of urinary bladder, to discuss etiology, pathophysiology, clinical feature, diagnosis and management of injuries of bladder. The possible question on this session can be: describe the etiology and clinical feature, investigation and management of injury to urinary bladder, surgical anatomy of the urinary bladder, intraperitoneal urinary bladder injury, extraperitoneal urinary bladder injury. You can add one more note on diagnosis of the urinary bladder injuries or the investigations for the diagnosis of urinary bladder injury. There are plenty of labels. It might be difficult for us to understand, or we just want to focus on the anatomy of bladder. So let us consider what are the important part of the bladder. So this portion, which is an angular one, which is directed outward or anterior and lying just behind this pubic symphysis, is called as the apex of the bladder. Now this next portion is called as the, which is on the upper side or upper superior side, that is called as the fundus of the bladder. This is fundus of the bladder, and the next main portion is called as the body of the bladder, and the next portion, which is actually lying posteriorly and in relation to the rectum, that is called as the base of the bladder. So remember, this bladder, though it is placed like an inverted cone into the pelvic cavity, so the broader part is upward and the triangular part is downward, but this broader part is not the base, but this posterior part, which is rested in relation to this rectum, is called as the base of the bladder. And now this portion, actually this will be more clear in the coronal section, this portion is called as the trigone of the bladder. The basic function of the bladder or urinary bladder is reservoir for the urine. If you see the location, while empty it lies completely in the true pelvis and expands upward towards the umbilicus when it is distended. And again, I will just go back, I will show you that this is the peritoneal fold. The bladder is completely extraperitoneal organ. It is just in contact with the peritoneum. It is covered, the upper surface is covered by the peritoneum, but it is not within the peritoneum. But this peritoneum fold is directly in contact with the superior surface of the bladder. So when this bladder distends like this, now it will come in very close contact with this peritoneum. Why this anatomy is important? Because this will divide the injuries either into the, if the injury is including or injury is passing through the peritoneum to the bladder, it will constitute intraperitoneal rupture. And if it is below this fold, then it will constitute the extraperitoneum. So that understanding is important, and this relation of this peritoneum to the upper surface of the bladder becomes very important. It almost forms a boundary. Now let us see how this bladder is placed. This bladder, see, that was the sagittal section, and now this is showing the dissected bladder. You can see this is a pubic bone. This is pelvis, and behind this pubic bone or within the true pelvis, the bladder is placed. So this is the bladder, this is again that peritoneal fold we were talking about. Then this rectum and the bladder, here there is a sort of a curtain, or there is a layer that gives a definite boundary between this bladder and this rectum, is called as a Denon-Villers fascia. See, this is called also called as a rectoprostatic fascia. Why this is important? Because this prevents the tumor's invasion into the rectum, and this is one of the very tough fascia. Here I want to show you the relation of the bladder to the vas deferens. You can see the vas deferens, which is arising from the testes here, is traveling upward. Here it is coming out through the superficial ring, traveling into the inguinal canal, and going posteriorly from the deep ring and traveling along the upper border of this bladder. Going back, it is lying now medial to the ureter, going back, joining to the seminal vesicle, and this union of this seminal vesicle and vas deferens will open into the utricle of prostate, and that prostate and that utricle is present in the prostatic urethra. So that is how this testis has got a connection to the bladder. So what are the sperm, what are the material from the seminal vesicle that is entering into the urethra? So it is not directly related to the bladder, but the outlet of the bladder, that is the prostatic urethra, is related to this. So you have to consider this posterior relation also. Now this is a important section. This is again a coronal section. What you can observe is that this is almost a circular like looking bag like a structure. This portion is called as the fundus, while this is called as the trigone. This trigone is a sensitive part of the bladder, and it is sensitive to the sensation of feeling. So when bladder is distended, then it will start contract, it will initiate the contraction, and that contraction will lead to the evacuation of the bladder. So this area between these two ureteric opening and the internal orifice, you can see this faint outline, and you can make out. So this is a triangular section that is called as the trigone. And now this, so this trigone is continuous with the urethra. One more comparison is very important. So what is the difference between the male bladder and female bladder? So the bladder as such, whether it is a male bladder or female bladder, it has got a similar structure, but the relations will be different, because in the male there is no presence of uterus, while the female bladder is related to the uterus. But more than what is important surgically is that the opening or the outlet of the bladder in female is very short. You can see this is only a 4 cm of a passage. You can see this is a straight passage, and it is broader one. If you compare it to the male version, you will realize that the bladder is connected to the exterior by a very complicated mechanism. Here the in female, the opening to the exterior is straight. There is hardly any obstruction. The urethra is uniformly broad throughout, and it is forming only a gate of 4 cm. So the chances of infection entering into the female bladder are more. Now if you compare the connection of the bladder to the exterior, so the distance is averagely 15 cm in adult. First, the bladder is connecting, or it is getting open through the prostatic urethra. Now this prostatic urethra, from the lower border of this prostate up to this penile bulb, is called as the membranous urethra. Now this membranous urethra is the narrowest part of the urethra, and later it will continue as the penile urethra. So this distance is almost 15 centimeter average, and that provides a sort of a protection. So the entry of the bacteria through this is difficult. So that is, but at the same time, the injuries to this structure, it becomes difficult to handle. The catheterization in female is easier, while the catheterization in male is slightly difficult. This is a coronal section again. This is a diagrammatic representation. You have already seen this diagram. So this will give you certain idea. If you can realize that this portion of fundus actually forms sort of a outpouching. So this portion, which is going towards the base, is slightly dependent. So first it gets filled up, and then it will come into the contact of this triangle. Some histology and the layers of the bladder. All of the genitourinary tract from the kidney to the urethra is lined by the transitional epithelium. So bladder is not exception. The whole bladder is lined by the transitional epithelium. Why it is important? Because the malignancy will belong to the transitional epithelium. But there is a certain exception that in case of bladder, you may have a squamous cell carcinoma in cases of schistosomiasis. Actually, that is because of a chronic friction or the chronic ulceration and the inflammation fibrosis caused by the schistosomia. So that converts this transitional epithelium into the squamous epithelium. That's why some of the malignancy are squamous cell carcinoma. So next step is let us consider the layers of the bladder. Now as you see here, this is the mucosa. Obviously it is divided into two parts. The innermost part forms the transitional epithelium, and this transitional epithelium is limited here by a basement membrane that is called as the lamina propria. Now we are seeing these layers from inside out. So outside this mucosa, you will find this is a submucosal layer. Out of this mucosa, there is the muscular layer. Now this muscular layer is again divided into two parts. This inner part is called as the superficial muscular layer, while the thicker part, which is deep or more outer, is called as the deep muscular layer. And the outermost part of the bladder is called as adventitia. Now again there is a difference. The area where the bladder is covered by the peritoneum, that is the upper portion, it is called as the serosa. And the rest of the places where the bladder is not covered by the peritoneum, the outermost layer is called as the adventitia. So let us have a brief idea regarding the arterial supply. As you are aware that bladder is a significantly vascular structure. Whenever there is a bladder injury, or if you want to operate on bladder, you have to be aware that it bleeds a lot because of this abundant blood supply. But for the same reason, because the blood supply is abundant, the injuries of the bladder gives a very good response while healing. So the arterial supply of the urinary bladder constitutes the superior vesical artery, the inferior vesical artery, obturator artery, and the inferior gluteal artery in male and female. While in female, there are uterine branches that supplies or gives the additional supply to the uterus. The venous drainage consists of the veins of the urinary bladder drains first into the vesical plexus of veins, which later drain into the intralacunar iliac vein, and then it goes upward. A mention about the lymphatic drainage. We will deal with this lymphatic drainage in the detail while we consider the pathology of the carcinoma bladder. But broadly, the lymphatics from the urinary bladder drain into the external as well as the internal iliac nodes. Now the nervous supply needs a very special mention in the bladder functioning. I am not going to discuss here in detail, but whenever you get time, you can prepare a special note on the nervous supply, because you will be dealing with two types of bladder. One is the neurogenic bladder, another is the autonomic bladder. So this has got a totally different mechanism. If it is a autonomic bladder, that is usually dealt by the surgeons, and if it is a neurogenic bladder, then the treatment becomes a medical treatment. But broadly, I will just mention the sympathetic fibers which supply the bladders are derived from the T11 to the L2 spinal segment, while the parasympathetic fibers which are supplying the urinary bladder are derived from the S2, S3 and S4 segment of the spinal cord. Now, as I said, you can prepare a note on the nervous supply of bladder, because the micturition reflex is one of the very major reflexes, which is a result of a complex interplay of the sympathetic, parasympathetic as well as the higher center interactions. So there are multiple diseases and multiple conditions which can result into the disturbances of the urinary function. With this brief introduction of anatomy, as I said, the anatomy was important. Before we go to this topic of the injuries to the urinary bladder, what is important for you to understand is that placement of the bladder, which is extraperitoneal. So the bladder is related to this fold, and that will create this terminology of extraperitoneal as well as intraperitoneal. Now, whenever there is a trauma, so this trauma, if it is involving the peritoneum and the bladder, it will constitute an intraperitoneal bladder injury. While if the peritoneum is not involved and the trauma is only in this portion, you can see this black line, which is I have shown to differentiate it between this. So that is a differentiating mark between this peritoneum. So if the injury is related below this peritoneal fold, that is called as an extraperitoneal injury. Out of this, 80% bladder injuries are extraperitoneal, while only 20% injuries of the bladder are intraperitoneal. You will understand why this is so. The reason is very simple. Most of the time, the bladder is empty. Whenever the bladder is filled, there will be a trigger, the trigone will initiate the voiding reflex and the person will empty the bladder. So there are less chances that bladder will be empty, bladder will be filled. So the chances of extraperitoneal injury are more, while it is rare that person will get an injury on a very full bladder. That's why only 20% of the injuries are intraperitoneal. Let us see the mechanism also. So why it is happening? Because due to distension, it is going near the peritoneal fold. Now try to understand. Once you imagine a person with a full bladder, how his bladder will get injury? Now any mechanism, for example, if a person get a blow on the lower abdomen or a kick or fails, then obviously he will have injury on this lower part of abdomen, and that blunt force will carry through this peritoneum over the bladder. So the bladder will rupture here, somewhere here, and that will have connection to the peritoneum. This injury called as an intraperitoneal bladder injury. So what can cause this? As I said, either person gets a blunt trauma like a blow or kick, or the lower abdomen, which is transmitted to the bladder. There is one more possibility, that if this person gets a penetrating injury, suppose now this is distended bladder up to this level, and he gets a stab or he falls over something that penetrates into his lower abdomen and finally injures and enters into the bladder. This will also constitute an intraperitoneal bladder injury. One more common, and that will be an iatrogenic injury. That will be because whenever you are operating in the lower abdomen, very common, though this is written as tubal ligation, hysterectomy, LSCS and pelvic surgery. The lower segment caesarean section, because it has to be done fast, sometimes there is a trauma to the bladder because of the impacted head. There might be prolonged labor which has caused stretching of the lower uterine segment as well as the bladder, and when you open it, then even a small cut can result into a injury to the bladder. Or any other, while you are operating in the lower abdomen, if you are not vigilant, then it is possible that bladder may get injuries. But the common situation where you get iatrogenic injuries are this. This is the list again. TL, I will repeat this: tubal ligation, hysterectomy, lower segment caesarean section, and the pelvic surgeries like Wardamsick hysterectomy or similar surgeries. Or if you are trying to explore the deeply invading ovarian tumors like that. Now there is a third mechanism you can understand: the cystoscopic intervention. Now it is very easy to understand. Where does the cystoscope enter? The cystoscope enters from this perurethrally, goes upward into the bladder. And there are multiple procedures which can be carried out which are directly related to bladder. For example, if there is a bladder stone and the urologist is trying to crush it, so what happens? He has to take support of this wall. But while sometimes you are trying to crush the stone, it may happen that your force become more and the cystoscope will cross through the, or it will cause trauma to the wall of the bladder and it will enter into the peritoneal cavity. So this will be again the iatrogenic injury. There is a one more surgery that is commonly known to cause bladder injury. What is that? That is called as a TURBT. TURBT means transurethral resection of bladder tumor. So suppose here is a bladder tumor and you are trying to resect it. So you are going layer by layer, layer by layer, layer by layer, but sometimes it has thinned out and you don't get the idea, and suddenly the bladder get ruptured. Obviously you are using a cautery current or the cutting current, so it may sometimes cause an inadvertent injury and that will result into the intraperitoneal bladder trauma. So that is a very commonly the happens because of the cystoscopic interventions. Now let us come to the next, that is a extraperitoneal injuries or the extraperitoneal bladder injuries or extraperitoneal bladder rupture. The mechanism, as you can understand, now this injury will remain in the pelvic part away from this peritoneal fold. That's why it is called as the extraperitoneal injury. How it can happen? You can understand, as I said, anatomy was important. The bladder is situated into the true pelvis. It is surrounded by the pelvic girdle. So anteriorly, what are the important bones? One is the pubic bone, another is the ischial bone. The posterior part of girdle is very heavy, so that usually doesn't get fractured or something like that. So more the anterior portion, the pubic bone and ischial bone, when they get fractured and this segment go backward, and that trauma or the fractured segment usually injures this bladder, resulting into the bladder injury, right? So that's why obviously if this is going back and causing the injury, it will not have connection to this peritoneum. That's why these type of injuries are extraperitoneal. Now sometimes this can happen that somebody is operating doing a APR, or somebody is doing the perineal surgery, or somebody is doing the rectal surgeries, and that can result into the trauma to this bladder. Next possibility is that yes, this is known to happen, that somebody is trying to do the bending, somebody is trying to operate upon the high hemorrhoids, or operating on the anal fissures, or somebody is operating on the fistula in anum. And because he doesn't get the idea regarding the depth, and there is a sudden injury to the urinary bladder, and that will obviously result into the extraperitoneal bladder injury. So let us see what are the clinical features of the bladder injury. So first let us consider the clinical feature of the extraperitoneal rupture. So whenever any patient comes with a pelvic fracture, the pelvic fracture, as I said, pelvic girdle is a very stable structure. It takes a significant trauma, or it takes a significant blow to cause this fracture. So whenever it happens, the trauma is so high, so you always suspect a bladder or urethral injury in case of pelvic fracture. Here we are not considering urethral injury because that is a separate topic, we will dealing it at the other time. But here what is important is that any patient coming with a pelvic fracture, you have to suspect the bladder trauma. Now if the urethra is intact and there is only bladder injury, suppose the obviously this has to be, if this is if the urethra is having rupture or urethra is having injury, then nothing will come out, and that urethral injury will itself cause a retention, so it will be difficult for you to diagnose it. But if a patient only has got a traumatic injury, and that is the extraperitoneal, so what will happen, whatever the age, that will keep on bleeding inside the bladder, outside the bladder, whatever goes outside, whatever the urine goes outside this bladder, gets collected into this perivesical area. And fortunately, because there is a protection of this peritoneum above, this will get caught within this perivesical space. And later, the water bleeding inside the bladder will present as a hematuria. And because there is a hematuria, there could be a clot which are intervening, and that will result into the difficulty in micturition, or patient will directly come with a passage of clot. Now, whenever it happens, then at least one thing, patient is passing the urine. So there is no immediate need to pass the catheter while you are examining. The next step is that you go for a per rectal examination. You enter your finger into this rectum, that is called as a digital rectal examination, or you commonly call it as per rectal examination. So what you will get, that patient will complain of a pain, you will feel the tenderness. And because there is a pericystic collection around this bladder, then that will result into the bogginess. But yes, you require some experience to understand that bogginess. But after doing multiple PR as a surgeon, you can easily make out, and you can fluctuate that material, and you will get that fluctuation or a bogginess, that is indication of an extraperitoneal bladder injury. Here is the injury which is limited to the extraperitoneal bladder injury. Now what I am going to talk about is the clinical features of the intraperitoneal injury. See, this arrow is indicative that the bladder is ruptured in connection to the peritoneum, and obviously whatever the urine inside will escape now into this peritoneum. That is why it is called as an intraperitoneal injury. So what will be the clinical feature? Actually, first clinical feature is very easy. At the time of escape, at the time of rupture, obviously there will be an initiating point, there will be a rupture, and the first point where the urine escapes into the peritoneum, at that point the patient will complain of a sudden severe pain. Now it depends that whether patient is able to perceive, because if this patient is having a road traffic accident, then his attention is into that. But if he is having a blow or kick, then he can immediately, because he is concentrated on that. So he will, at the time of escape of this urine, he will complain of sudden severe pain in the hypogastric. Now, it may be followed by shock. See, there is a one thing, bladder is not that chemical, or urine is not chemically that strong as compared to the gastric fluid. So the insert which is infected by urine is not as high as the gastric content or the duodenal content. So when this happens, patient may, there is a possibility, but most of the patient will not show any sign of shock. It will be limited only to the severe pain. And later, the patient will develop a picture like chemical peritonitis. Now this, how the picture develops, how much the peritonitis develops, that will depend upon the nature of the urine. If the person is having infected urine, then the chances of chemical peritonitis will be more. And if the urine is sterile, then the chemical peritonitis will occur slowly. So initial stage, yes, first is the impact, followed by the escape of urine, there is a sudden severe pain and patient may or may not develop the shock, and there will slowly develop the picture of chemical peritonitis. After the time escape, then certain clinical feature will become obvious. Because now this urine is continuously leaking into the peritoneum. And see, peritoneum is a big cavity. It can almost accommodate up to 3 or 4 meter. So the patient will not show any desire because the bladder is not getting filled. The trigone is not getting stimulated and the urine is continuously escaping. In that case, the clinical symptom is that the patient will not pass urine for a significant time. And therefore, obviously, he will not pass perurethrally. Dull nodes over the abdomen. Next is that, how will you confirm that this patient is having a bladder injury which is connected to the bladder? Now, same thing. First, you can go for a very careful catheterization. Here, usually the urethra is intact, so there won't be any problem. But there is a one more additional problem that you can imagine. When you catheterize the patient reveals that empty bladder. That means not much of a urine will come out. Water that is collected in a slight amount may come, and there might be hematuria that can be noted. But in general, there won't be any significant output. There are one more chances that while you are introducing, the catheter may go through the rent. It is known to happen. That can also create a problem. And there is a something interesting can happen. That in initial stages, obviously, as this is an intraperitoneal injury, the injury will be to the this superficial part, or the this is the superior part which is in contact with the peritoneum. Now, initially, the urine will start escaping into the peritoneum, and also the peritoneum will start pouring into the its own cavity, right? So everything will collect into peritoneum. Now you are aware that this bladder is situated at the lower abdomen in the dependent position. Now when this patient stands, there is a possibility that now the whole collected fluid which is in the peritoneum now enter into the bladder, and there is a dependent draining. So this is interesting finding you will many times find in your ward. So that is called as the dependent draining. So that does not happen in the initial stage, but may happen when there is a collection outside the collection within the peritoneal cavity, which later drains into the dependent bladder through the rent. Now you will confirm this with a USG or a ultrasonography. The finding will be that of an empty bladder, and as you go up, the peritoneum will be filled with the urine or fluid. And because there is a history of an injury in the region of bladder, so that will give you an indirect diagnosis. You cannot say definitely, because it could be an empty bladder with a peritonitis, but you will get idea about this with a two method. One of the method is you go for the peritoneal fluid aspiration, that is called as the peritoneal paracentesis. This is same as you are doing for the ascitic tapping. So you do the peritoneal tapping, bring out the fluid, take a smell, and it will give you the smell of urine. And if it is a delayed peritonitis, then it will give you purulent fluid, but there is a distinct smell of a urine that clinches the diagnosis of intraperitoneal bladder injury. Additional thing, as you already have a polycatheter placed into the bladder, which you can confirm the position, you can confirm with the sonography, and then add through it the dye, and which you can very well notice escaping into the peritoneal cavity under the image intensifier. So that will be a easy clinching of the diagnosis. Now what is not I have described is the CT scan. The same thing you can confirm with a CT scan, and nowadays CT scan with a three-dimensional construction can give you exact location of the bladder injury. So you have a good preoperative diagnosis and you know the location, so your treatment becomes. So how do you manage? This is one of the important aspect. The patient who are coming with a bladder trauma are usually ill patient. See, we have divided the bladder injury into two classes. One is the intraperitoneal, which is only 20%, while the extraperitoneal is 80%. And this 80% extraperitoneal injuries are because of the pelvic fracture. So major portion of the bladder injury which are presenting to you are usually serious because of their consideration of their pelvic fracture, which might have caused due to a significant trauma, either a road traffic accident, motor accident, industrial accident, or getting caught into the two bodies or two major industrial bodies. That is one of the reason, and that is associated. So your basic treatment is first directed toward the resuscitation of the patient, stabilize the patient, they treat the shock and hemorrhage first, start the patient on IV fluid, put on the oxygen, start him on the blood transfusion, or the you can give the blood substitute initially. So that management is first, because bladder rupture can wait. First you have to stabilize. Once everything is given, if all other things are, now you are dealing with the bladder injury. So you have established whether this is a intraperitoneal injury or it's a extraperitoneal injury. Now there is definite treatment. All the patients of the bladder rupture, whether it is intraperitoneal or extraperitoneal, they will require exploration and they will require surgical repair. So there is no role for any conservative management. If we are talking about the conservative management, that is for the bladder injury with a contusion, or there is a hematuria due to blood trauma bladder, which has not resulted into the breach of the wall of the bladder. So whenever there is a breach of wall, if there is a puncture, if there is a rupture, that needs to be repaired surgically. So that there is no role of a conservative treatment for that. If you are very high institute, you can attempt through the cystoscope, fiber optic cystoscope, and the modern methodology. Otherwise, you can go laparoscopically also, or you can go with a open surgical approaches. So let us see what are the general principles of the treatment. What method you choose will depend upon the resources available to you. As I said, you can deal it with a fiber optic from inside, you can deal with a laparoscopy, or you can deal with a open surgical approach. So when the patient enters, when you are starting the treatment, the first is the careful catheterization. The next is establish the injury. So follow the protocol, do the various investigation and deduction, you will come to know whether this is intraperitoneal or extraperitoneal. Now this classification of intraperitoneal and extraperitoneal is very important, because that will change your operative approach. So let us first consider the extraperitoneal injury. For this, at least you have to see it once. You have to enter into the OT once you see at least one operative for the bladder stone or the cystomethotomy, then you will realize what I am talking. See, when you open the lower abdomen, first you open what? First you open the, you take a skin incision, then divide the fascia, then you enter onto the rectus and there are muscles. Once you divide the muscles, you land up on the peritoneum. So when you are doing the abdominal surgery, you take an incision over peritoneum and you enter into the peritoneal cavity where you can observe the intestines. Now the idea for the bladder is, for the bladder, you take an infraumbilical incision, or another is the transverse Hammerstein incision. Then you go up to the level of the exposing the peritoneum. Now here is the difference. Now this peritoneal fold, which is lying in the lower portion, just behind the pubic symphysis. Now you can reflect it upward, so that peritoneal cavity is not breached, it is not open. So with the help of a sponge or with the help of a swab, you can reflect that peritoneal fold upward so that you will expose the bladder. Bladder can be identified because of the straight muscles. And you can see the bleeding, you can see the collection, but in extraperitoneal injury, the approach is to reflect the peritoneal fold upward so as to expose the bladder. Now, once you expose the bladder, if the injury is visible, fine. But it may happen that injury may not be in the superior, part or into the dome. The dome is a quite an area where you can reach from all the side. So most of the time you come across the injury. But if you see the injury, it is fine. Now once you see the injury, you catch the edges with a Babcock forceps, then clean it with the saline, do the suction aspiration and properly expose the wound in all direction. Now don't start repairing this wound immediately. Now through this wound, you clean the bladder from inside, take out the clots, give a wash, and then from inside you have to examine. Nowadays the modern methods will come to you. Through that rent you can insert the camera and see the interior, or otherwise you can insert with your finger and palpate for injuries. So with experience you can find out if there is an injury inside, then you can extend this present wound and through that injury locate that wound, suture it from inside. Then once that is done, give a wash, see everything from inside, then come to the major wound and suture that. Okay, that is the approach for the extraperitoneal injury. Now sometime it may happen that when you open the fundus, you may not see any of the injury, but all other investigation and the surrounding, there is a bleeding, there is a collection, so that gives you idea that there is a injury. In that case, you can open through the fundus, take an incision, then explore the bladder, or at the same time if you have, you can enter with the cystoscope also at a time. So you can use a multi-site approach to deal with this bladder. But main thing is find out all the injuries and repair them with an absorbable suture. Suture the wound in two layers. The first layer, that is the approximating layer, and the second layer, that is the Lambert's burying layer. One more precaution you have to take: when you are suturing the bladder, make sure that your knots will come outside. They will not placed inside into the mucosal part. If you leave the knots inside the bladder mucosa, then that will become a nidus or a platform for stone formation. So that is always avoided. So once you take care of the bladder, then you keep a retropubic drain and then close your incision. Now if it is an intraperitoneal injury, it is opening is similar, but only thing, now you open the peritoneum, and through the peritoneum you will find out that it is easier to find out the injury. Most of these intraperitoneal bladder injuries are present in the fundic part. So you find them, you open the peritoneum, visualize them, and then take care of this, separate the peritoneum from it, then repair the bladder in two layers. Also same, follow the same methods. Explore the, open the wound, clean the clots, examine the interior for any additional injuries, and take care of the all injuries. Then you have to give a thorough wash through the intraperitoneal cavity, keep a drain into the peritoneum and one retropubic drain. Close the peritoneum which is breached, so that now these cavities are different, and put a retropubic drain and keep the Foley catheter for almost 2 weeks. Before you remove the Foley catheter, don't forget to do a dye study. And usually, because of, as I said, there is abundant blood supply, they get healed very rapidly. The complication chances are the patient, the wound can get infected. Somebody, if there can be a leakage after some time, but it usually does not happen, and whenever it happens, they can be re-explored and corrected easily. So here we end the main topic of our bladder injuries. And I will just give you an idea regarding which can be asked as a short note. It can be asked to enlist the causes. It can be asked of, as a brief answer question. So I will give you just an idea regarding the causes of the retention of urine. Retention of urine obviously applies to the bladder. Before I enter into this part, you should understand any structure which is a reservoir of a urine and is evacuating through a tubular opening, how it can get obstructed. So there is a tubular structure, urethra, through which the bladder is opening outside. So there are only three mechanisms by which the bladder will get retained, bladder will get obstructed, and this applies to all tubular structure, whether it is intestine, whether it is any tube, it is trachea, esophagus, or urethra, bladder opening, ureters. So the mechanism is called, this is a tube, so something which is obstructing this tube from inside. So this is a loose body which is getting impacted inside this tube. So this kind of obstruction is called as intramural obstruction, right? So this is a loose body, say it could be a clot, it could be a stone, or it could be anything, or a mucus plug like that, and that gets caught here. Or it could be a worm, it could be a parasite, and that causes obstruction. That obstruction is called an intramural obstruction. Now this is a tube, and something is pressing over the tube from outside. Now this from outside could be a tumor, another growing, this could be a malignancy, or something that is invading the tube from outside. So this kind is known as extramural obstruction. So usually these are the outside pathologies which are pressing over the tube. And third possibility is that the tube may get obstructed because of something which is arising from the wall of this tube itself. So what is this? This could be a urethrocele or a ureterocele. This could be an aneurysm. This could be a dissecting aneurysm, or there could be, that is, I am giving examples. So this is not, bladder cannot have aneurysm. And another thing is that if this is a urethra, it can cause the rupture urethra. Obviously, when you are talking about a rupture urethra or traumatic urethra, the cause is in the wall. So any obstruction is because of only these three mechanisms. One is intramural, this is mural, and this is extramural. So this will give you a good idea how the bladder will get retained. So what are the causes? So let us talk about the causes which are common in male as well as female. So in male, the common causes are urethral stricture, acute urethritis or prostatitis. Now you know the reason. What are the different urethritis? Previously they were gonorrheal urethritis, there were gonococcal urethritis, like that. Then there could be a bladder outlet obstruction, that is called as a BOO, which is the commonest cause for the acute retention. And if you are talking about the adult, then phimosis is also one of the cause which happens in the older adults. Usually the patient who are developing diabetes, and diabetes will cause them the balanitis, balanoposthitis, and that will lead to the inflammation, then fibrosis, and they will develop into the phimosis, and later it becomes so tight that it will develop into the retention. And yes, it is very common cause into the children. Now in the female, the common causes are retroverted gravid uterus. This can happen two times. In the first trimester it is possible, and it is also possible into the third trimester also because of the increased lower segment. Then same bladder neck obstruction, but it is rare in the female while it is common in the males. Now as I said, blood clot and urethral calculus, these are the intramural causes. Rupture of the urethra or the neurogenic injury, that constitutes a mural causes. Then sometimes the smooth muscle cell function dysfunction, that can cause retention. And this is interesting, a fecal impaction. So fecal impaction is not inside the urethra, but there is a female fecal impaction in the rectum, and that presses from behind. As I said, this is the extramural cause. So that presses over the urethra from behind, and that causes. There is one more reason, that patient who are having anal pain, typically the patient of fissure, typically the patient of the hemorrhoids, which are the bulky hemorrhoids, or the patient who undergoes hemorrhoidectomy, and they develop a severe spasm, and that causes the spasm of the urethra also, and that develops into the retention. And there are some drugs, you can make a list of these drugs, and that causes the retention. And very commonly spinal anesthesia. As I said, you have to read about the details of the sensory and parasympathetic supply to the bladder. So obviously when you are giving a spinal anesthesia, that mechanism is blocked. So the mechanism is hampered. Mechanism of voiding is hampered. The stimulus from the trigone is not responded, and this is a timing phenomenon, and usually that develops into the acute retention. How the patient will present? Now this is important, that no urine is passed for several hours. So what is the difference between the acute retention and anuria or the oliguria? So remember, in anuria or oliguria there is also no passage of urine for several hours, but in that the basic production of urine is suffered. The kidneys are not produced, the kidneys are in shock. Maybe there could be any reason. It may be a pre-renal cause, renal cause, or a post-renal cause, but there is a problem in the urine production in cases of anuria or oliguria. In cases of retention, there is no problem with the kidney function. Kidneys are perfectly producing the amount to be produced by them. It is getting collected into the bladder. Only the evacuation is not possible because of different reason. So what it happens? Now there are two types obviously. One is acute retention and chronic retention. Here we are dealing with the acute retention. So patient who is having the first episode of a retention will be in a severe discomfort. He will present with a pain. Now when the patient comes, he will obviously give you the complaint that he is not able to pass the urine. He keeps on trying to void, but nothing comes out. Then you examine this patient, and what you find? That the suprapubic area, you can visualize the bladder, which is growing towards the umbilicus. See, in case of urinary retention, you will always observe the bladder between the pubic symphysis and up to the umbilicus. So depending upon the amount, it will keep on growing toward the umbilicus. Then if you try to palpate, it will be tender, and if you percuss it, then you will get a dull note. So these are typical. A lump which is appeared suddenly, patient who is not able to pass urine, and the continuity above the pubic symphysis, that you cannot insinuate your fingers below this pubic symphysis, and that bladder is continuous towards the umbilicus. And if you percuss, you will get a definite dull note. These are very simple clinical criteria of diagnosis. Your diagnosis will be 96% right. There might be difficulty sometimes. Suppose a patient comes with impacted stone. There is a stone in the membranous urethra, or there is a urethral stone which is beyond your reach. You cannot remove it without going for a cystoscopy, and urologist is not available. Then what you will do? Your catheter is there, so you can keep on forcing the catheter into the urethra, because if the stone is midway, you cannot push it back. So what are the alternatives? So the first alternative is that you can use suprapubic syringe aspiration. That means, as I said, the first method of diagnosis, which is not to be done. But if you don't have any choice, if you cannot insert the catheter and patient is in so much pain, so with the help of ultrasonography guidance, you can go. The next easy method and very commonly used in our world is suprapubic catheterization. So this is a suprapubic catheter, commonly called as a SupraCat. Is available in ready-made packages, in a pre-sterile package. It costs around, say, 300 rupees, and you can ask for the different size. So it is just like your Foley catheter. Only difference is that inside this there is a trocar. So this is a long needle which is jutting outside this tip. So under this USG guidance, just above some 1 centimeter above the over the pubic symphysis, you take a small incision around 1 centimeter, and under this sonographic guidance, insert this catheter inside. While you are inserting, the balloon is deflated. Once you are inside, you remove this trocar, so the urine will start draining for here. Immediately blocking this outlet, you fix this catheter to the skin and inflate the balloon inside, so it will remain inside the bladder. Now you connect this channel to the urisac, and this will remain till you can take any definitive action about the obstruction which is causing urine. So this is a common method that is called as a suprapubic use of a this is a suprapubic cystostomy using a SupraCat. These are the commercially easily available instrument present in almost every medical store. Sometimes if this is also not available, then you can go for a open suprapubic cystostomy. The method, actually this is only of a historical mention. Nowadays you will get SupraCat everywhere. So this is what you do about the acute urinary retention. Thank you very much.